Okay, so in this video, we're going to go over the history of cells. We'll talk a little bit about their discovery. We'll talk about the cell theory. We'll go into the kinds of cells, such as prokaryotes and eukaryotes. We'll talk about the diversity of cells. And then we'll finish with how we think cells may have become a little more complex over the years. So let's go ahead and get started. Okay, so the first thing I want to mention is the history of cells. And one thing to mention is that all life is made from cells. Well, this is a pretty basic, simplistic statement today, but there was a time in our science understanding where this was not known to us. Keep in mind that the cell itself wasn't even discovered until the 1600s with the invention of the microscope. Here we have a picture of the microscope that actually discovered cells. This was a microscope that belonged to a gentleman by the name of Robert Hooke. And Robert Hooke, in 1665, he first observed cork, which happened to be dead tree bark. And now here's a picture of what perhaps might be Robert Hooke. We're not even sure. Most likely, this isn't a picture of Robert Hooke because there have been no known pictures of him that have survived. This happened to be a picture that was on the Wikipedia page, and so I borrowed it. But here we have a picture of some cork, which is again basically tree bark. Cork is the bark of a type of oak tree. So pretend he sliced a real thin layer and then put it underneath that microscope from a moment ago. Let's zoom on in and see what he saw. When we zoom on in, here's the actual drawing that Robert Hooke made back in 1665. I think I'm kind of blown away that this is a hand-drawn image right here. He was very artistic, you can see. And notice that the cells that he drew all appear to be empty. Well, this is because cork cells are dead. All he was looking at is the outer cell wall of the plant cells. All the inner parts have long since decayed and decomposed and worn away. So he really wasn't looking at anything living. In fact, when Robert Hooke first observed cork, he had no idea that cells were alive. But he saw these little boxes, and he kind of, an analogy here. He said, these things kind of reminded him of tiny rooms, and another name for a tiny room would be a cell. And so the name has kind of stuck. So as time goes by, we learn more and more and more about cells, and we've now have one of the cornerstones of modern biology, which is the cell theory. And so there's three basic parts to the cell theory. But before we get into the three parts, here we have a picture of a gentleman by the name of Matthias Schleiden, a German botanist. A botanist is a person who studies plants. And so he was studying plant after plant, looking at the structure of plants, and he noticed that all plant structures were composed of cells. And then here's another German scientist, a German physiologist by the name of Theodor Schwann. And Schwann and Schleiden were actually buddies, and they hung out and they went to dinner together and they discussed their observations. And based on their discussions, Schleiden's discussion about plants, Schwann, this guy in the picture, Theodor Schwann, he was working on cells, studying animal cells, and he made a similar conclusion that not just plants are based on cells, but so are animals. And so he took this a step even further and concluded that all life, plant and animal, is composed of cells. And that really is part one to our cell theory. All organisms are made of cells. Part two of the cell theory is that the cell is the most basic unit of life. Now, here we have a picture of a cell, and you can see there's a few parts labeled: lysosomes, nucleus, mitochondria, Golgi body, rough, smooth ER. So my question is, if cells clearly have smaller parts to them, so why is the cell called the basic unit of life and not the smaller parts? Well, the answer is actually pretty straightforward. Even though cells have smaller parts, like a mitochondria, like a rough ER, those smaller parts cannot function and cannot operate on their own. A Golgi body removed from a cell ceases to function. A lysosome removed from a cell ceases to function. And so the basic unit of life that can still carry on and survive and function on its own is the cell. And then here comes a third gentleman to kind of finish off the cell theory, and this is another German doctor by the name of Rudolf Virchow. And he was a doctor, and he was working with sick people, and he was examining their cells underneath a microscope, and he noticed that cells multiply and come from other cells. And this really is the final part to the cell theory, is that cells don't just poof out of nowhere. And there was a time when cells, we actually thought that cells could just spontaneously generate, where we thought life could just poof into existence. And so that this cell theory is really our modern, the beginnings kind of of modern cell theory or modern cell biology here. Now, when you combine the work of Schleiden, Schwann, and Virchow, we again have these what's called the cell theory. But there really is a big problem with this theory, and I hope you can identify that as part number three. Cells come from other cells. Well, if that's true, those who argue against the cell theory, and there are still some who do argue against the cell theory, one of the arguments they make is, where did the first ever cell come from? And a legitimate question that science right now really just doesn't have a good understanding. Science does not have a good understanding for how life could have begun, how cells could have begun. So that really is one of the big dilemmas and the big mysteries of cell biology. Okay, so next I'd like to go into the diversity of cells. And one thing I want you guys to know is that the shape of a cell really depends upon its function. You know, you can flip through any biology textbook and you kind of see pictures like this. Plant cells, animal cells are pretty much universally depicted as the same in textbooks. Plants are depicted as kind of a rectangular or square shaped cell, and animals are kind of depicted as a round circular shaped cell. And keep in mind that when you see diagrams like this in your textbook, these are very just simplistic general statements. Not every animal cell is round, not every plant cell is rectangular. So what we're going to do is go into some of the diversity of cells. So here's a great example of how not all animal cells are round. Here's a nerve cell. You can see it's not round. It has these branches coming out in various directions. It's the body of a nerve cell is very stringy and elongated, and this helps do its function. The function of a nerve cell is to send electrical messages to and from the brain. That's what you see in the animation. That yellow object is supposed to be symbolic of an electrical message traveling to and from the brain. Well, when you think of what is the advantage of nerve cells having this shape to them, well, the advantage is pretty simple. Those signals, those messages that go to and from the brain, they can travel a variety of directions. And that's good, because what if somebody has some nerve damage? What if some of those branches have been damaged due to some kind of accident? Well, if some branches are damaged, but other branches remain intact, there's a good chance the person can still send messages to and from the brain, and they won't have very severe disabilities. But if all of their branches are damaged and they're not able to send any messages to and from the brain, that person very well could suffer from some sort of paralysis. You know, a good analogy for a nerve cell is when we look at a map of the United States. Pretend that you wanted to drive from City A to City B. And my question says, could you get from City A to City B if Interstate 80 was suddenly closed? Interstate 80 is the red line in between City A and City B. Could you get to City B if Interstate 80 were closed? The answer should be obvious. Absolutely, yes. You just have to go a different direction. You may have to use one of those blue routes to get to City B. So you may have to go out of your way a little bit, but eventually you could still get to City B. Just go a different direction. The same works with nerve cells. If your nerve cells have damage to them, if some of the branches of a nerve cell have damage, there's a good chance the message can still get to and from the brain just by traveling different directions around other branches. Another type of cell I want to mention are red blood cells. And you can see that they're round and disc-like in shape. Well, this really helps them do their function. Their function is to carry oxygen throughout the blood. You know, there's a reason we put round tires on automobiles. Round tires help an automobile roll and use less energy as as you drive down the road. Well, here's a vein with RBCs traveling through them. RBCs stands for red blood cells. And you know, there are parts of the body where the veins and arteries are so narrow that red blood cells have to travel through them single file. They're that thin. And so clearly, having round red blood cells allows them to roll, hopefully not get stuck in those narrow veins and arteries. And last example on this one, on this slide here, are skin cells. Their shape is very broad and very flat. Well, that really helps them perform their function. You might know the function of skin cells is to cover and protect the body. So having cells that are broad and flat allows them to cover more area. Not only are skin cells broad and flat to cover more area, but the skin cells actually overlap one another. You probably know that skin cells come in various layers. And so by having cells, a skin cell overlap and overlap and overlap another skin cell, it adds more and more layers of protection. A great analogy is, for instance, like this roof here. Here's a picture of a roof, and these are shingles on a roof. Your skin cells act like shingles on a roof. So when it rains, you know, the water just simply rolls down the shingles and onto the ground, and more importantly, it stays dry on the inside. So having skin cells arranged like shingles really does help keep out unwanted materials. Your skin is really the first line of defense. Your skin keeps out viruses, keeps out bacteria, and so your skin is really your first line of defense in your immune system. Okay, the next thing I want to mention are two broad categories of cells. In the picture, we have a category of cells known as a prokaryote, and these are cells that do not possess a nucleus and other membrane-bound organelles. You know, in middle school, perhaps you had to build a shoebox diagram, a shoebox model of a cell, and in building that model, perhaps you labeled things mitochondria and the rough ER and the Golgi body. You might be wondering, where are those things in this picture? Prokaryotes do not have those. The parts I just mentioned, a nucleus, a mitochondria, a chloroplast, a rough ER, a Golgi body, these are all membrane bound. Prokaryotes don't have them. So these are the simplest cells on Earth. Not only are they the simplest cells on Earth, but we also think they're the oldest. They're the first cells, the first life to ever inhabit planet Earth. And the reason we think this, number one, is they're the simplest in structure, but number two, when we look at the fossil record, you know, we find evidence of prokaryotic life about 3.5, 3.6 billion years ago. And so that really does predate the earliest other kind of cells, which we'll mention in just a moment. Prokaryotes have a more common name to them. You may have simply heard them called bacteria. So bacteria are prokaryotes, and prokaryotes are bacteria. If I were to ask you, do bacteria have a nucleus? You could say no, they don't, because bacteria are prokaryotes, and they don't have a nucleus or other membrane-bound organelles. Okay, the second category of cells, besides a prokaryote, is a eukaryote. And these are really just the opposite. These are cells that do possess a nucleus and membrane-bound organelles. So these cells are much more complex. When you look at the diagram, you see a lot of the parts that you perhaps labeled when you maybe made a shoebox model in middle school. You know, you can see the nucleus because it's membrane bound. You can see a mitochondria. It too has an outer membrane to it. You can see the Golgi apparatus. It has an outer membrane to it. So eukaryotic cells are much more complex. Not only are they more complex, but we think they evolved from prokaryotes. We think that bacteria, prokaryotic bacteria, were the first inhabitants of Earth, and later on, eukaryotes evolved from them. We find evidence of eukaryotes around 2 billion years ago, and that very much is after prokaryotes. Prokaryotes appear to come first, and eukaryotes appear to come second. So we'll go into how we think prokaryotes eventually led to the evolution of eukaryotes in just a moment. But here's a quick list of examples of cells that are eukaryotic. Here is an amoeba, which is a type of protista. If you're not familiar with protista, they're organisms that microscopic, one cell in size, that kind of live in pond water. I'm sure you're familiar with mushrooms. Mushrooms are a type of fungus. I'm sure you're familiar with trees. Trees are a type of plant. And I'm sure you're familiar with frogs. Frogs are a type of animal. Humans are also a type of animal. And so humans, very much, our cells are eukaryotic. Okay, so here's the final topic, is the evolution of eukaryotes. Well, the evolution of eukaryotes can really be summed up with a theory called the endosymbiosis theory. Now, this theory tries to explain how the mitochondria and the chloroplast became a part of the cell. Well, at one time, kind of a neat little theory here, at one time, we're pretty certain that the chloroplast and the mitochondria were both free-living organisms. In the picture, I just have a chloroplast ancestor in the picture. I didn't draw the mitochondria in this picture just for simplicity, and I didn't want to have too much clutter once we go through this animation. Well, so if science believes that the mitochondria and chloroplasts were once free living organisms, and this is called a theory, there has to be evidence to support that theory. And the evidence is actually pretty overwhelming. The mitochondria and the chloroplast each contain their own DNA. That right there is some of the best evidence that the mitochondria and chloroplast used to be an organism all by themselves. It's also interesting to note that the mitochondria and chloroplast can replicate and multiply. They have their own ribosomes. They make their own proteins. So they do a lot of cellular functions, even though they today, the chloroplast and the mitochondria, are not cells. They are parts of cells. It's kind of interesting. They're almost like a cell trapped inside of a bigger cell. Well, how did this happen? What's the process for how this took place? Well, in the animation we're about to go through, here we have a large orange cell, and it's engulfing the green chloroplast ancestor. Well, now this large orange cell has an advantage, and this is where we get into the endosymbiosis theory. If you can trap, for instance, that green chloroplast ancestor, that orange larger cell now has an advantage. Chloroplasts, you may know, do photosynthesis and they make sugar. If you can have a part designed to make food for yourself, you now have an advantage over your competitors. And so each, the green chloroplast and the orange larger cell continue to multiply. So in my animation, the green chloroplasts are multiplying and becoming more plentiful, but they're all trapped inside of this large oranger cell. Well, that large orange cell is going to grow and divide and break into two and multiply as well. So now we have two cells that have an advantage of making sugar by having these chloroplast parts inside of them. And this process simply continues over and over and over again. And over time, each has become completely dependent on one another. The chloroplast and the mitochondria are dependent on the orange cell for protection. And yet the orange cell is completely dependent on the mitochondria because it helps make energy, and dependent on the green chloroplast because it helps make food. And so this is really a summary of the endosymbiosis theory and how we think eukaryotic cells became into existence. And so as we wrap up this video, go ahead and pause the video. If you're in my biology class, pause the video and try to answer these 9 questions here. Put them on a separate sheet of paper. I'd be happy to check your answers for accuracy, either before school or after school one day. Good luck.